you're watching this video, there's a pretty good chance that you are deep in the weeds of map making. And I'd wager that there's a pretty good chance you're also fans of the J.R.R. Tolkien series, Lord of the Rings. This is the fold-out map insert included with my copy that I got when I was a little kid. Actually, my sister got it, but I've stolen it since then. It was drawn by Christopher Tolkien, J.R.R. Tolkien's son. It has a simple, charming aesthetic that's pretty much become synonymous with fantasy mapping. In this series, I'm going to walk through how to create styles reminiscent of this using GIS software so that you can make fantastic maps of real places. We'll cover forests, mountains, and water. And then we can put all those symbols together into one map to rule them all. In this first video, it's all about the trees. When I look at these forest areas, I see three distinct steps. A perimeter of trees to define the forest edge, a filler method of drawing semicircles and cones, and lastly, a cute little row of tree trunks along the bottom edge of the forest. These will be the symbol layers that we'll try to replicate for our digital forests. And because we're the captain of our own ships, we'll add a little something extra. Well, here we are in ArcGIS Pro. My first step is going to be changing the map's background color to something like a light tan, a khaki, kind of like the page of a book or an old map. I'll open up the symbology panel for this layer and choose the structure tab. And I'm going to add a symbol layer called marker layer. And I can get rid of the regular outline because I'm going to turn this marker layer into a dotty outline. And I'll choose a long line with random size for the marker placement. Now I'm going to change the size to 4 points, and then I'll snug them all together by that same amount, 4 points. And next, I can change its color to be the same as my background color. And I'll give it an outline width of 0.8 points, and I'll make it a very dark gray, kind of like the printed ink on a page. And I'll uncheck scale proportionally so I can have an idea of how thick the outline is going to be. And then I'm going to add an effect called wave, just to give it a little bit of a nuance around the edges so it doesn't look quite like a bubble ringed blob. And I'll give this wave form a wave height of 3 points and a wave length of 6 points. And now let's turn our cartographic attention to that fill. I made a pattern of just a bunch of semicircles and cones in Photoshop. I'll put a link to it in the description. And then, in a desperate attempt to reduce the visual artifacts that happen at the seams, when these things are tiled over and over again next to each other, I copy the top row of trees and I paste them onto the bottom row of trees, spilling halfway out of view. Is it perfect? No. Is it good enough? Yeah. So I'll change the solid fill, which is the default, to picture fill. And then I'll navigate to the image I just made. The fill image I made is 80 by 80 pixels, but ArcGIS Pro works in points. So if I multiply that by 0.75, I know that it's 60 points. This keeps this picture fill nice and crispy. You may be wondering why I made the tree fill symbols white instead of that khaki color. That's because you can tint anything that's white to whatever color you want. And I'll use the eyedropper tool to tint this picture's white pixels khaki. And that means if I want to change my map's colors later, I can do it right here in Pro instead of having to go back to Photoshop. Onto those cute little tree trunks. In the Structure tab, I'm going to duplicate that original marker layer that draws a perimeter around my forests, and I'm going to drag it to the very bottom. And instead of having a beaded necklace sort of look, I'm going to change the shape from a circle to a line. I'll make it a little skinnier and a little longer, like tree trunks, and I'll change its color to that dark gray. But you can't really see these changes yet because they're behind the other layers. So I'm going to add the move effect, and I'll just nudge it down by giving it a Y of -2. And you may notice that my tree trunks are pointed in all kinds of wonky directions. So I'll uncheck angle to line, and now they all point straight down, just as nature intended. I'd like to make them a little denser though. So instead of a placement template of 4, I'm going to make it a placement template of 3. So every 3 points, a new tree trunk is planted. Now the thickness of these symbols means we've actually pushed out the geography that it covers. And so we need to remedy this by sucking it back in. Here's how to do that. Now I'm going to go back to the Structure tab and I'm going to add a global effect, and that global effect will be offset. And then whoosh, over in the Symbol tab, I can apply that offset and I'm going to give it the option of accurate, and then I'm going to make it -4, and that snugs it in 4 points, bringing our chunky symbology back in line with the true geography that it's covering. And one of the easiest and best ways to make these ancient paper maps look ancient and paper is to give them a paper texture. I've made a handful of paper texture tile layers, and I've shared measured them on Living Atlas. So I'll add some of those to my map. I'll add data, and within the Living Atlas tab, I'll search for paper texture, and I'll add parchment and folded. And now our map has a nice tangible context. I'm gonna drag these two texture layers to the top, and then I'm gonna use blend modes to cook these into my map. For the parchment texture, I'll give it a multiply blend mode, and for the folded paper texture, I'm gonna give it a color burn blend mode. And now our map lives in a rich, papery world that makes me want to reach out and touch it. Well, at this point, we've done a pretty serviceable job of creating a Tolkien-esque forest symbol. But there's no reason we have to stop here. We can breathe our own bit of personality into this. I'm going to add a little bit of shading and some cool tinting, like somebody kind of watercolor tinted around the edge of this forest. Does that sound like fun, Sparrow? Let's do this. I'll go to the Structure tab, and I'm going to duplicate my row of tree trunks. And this new tree trunk row, I'm gonna make a little bit longer, so a length of 10 points instead of 6 points. And then the big trick is to rotate them. My imaginary sun is in the top left because that's where imaginary suns live. And I'll give this a negative 120 degree angle rotation, and then pew, 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 I've got some rotated tree trunks that look kind of shady. And then I'll just play with this move effect so that the shadows have the right origin point. At this point, I'm gonna get a little bit devious and dive one level deeper into this nested symbol. I'll expand the shape line symbol and choose format. And here in the deep recesses of this symbology, I'll choose the structure and add a global effect called tapered polygon. And then I'll give my shape a new fill layer. And if we take a closer look at what we've just done, I've made cool little tapered triangles. And that's all I need. I don't need that original outline, so I'll delete that. And back in the layers, I'm gonna give this a gradient fill instead of a solid fill. And I'll make its properties linear and continuous, so it's smooth looking. And then I can just play with the colors. At this point, I'm gonna introduce a little bit of hue into our vintage map. And my inspiration for this is those beautiful old maps that would use like a watercolor tinting around the edge of features to give it some liveliness. We'll give it a nice deep foresty green, and then I'm gonna cut its transparency in half, so 50% transparent. And I'll get this color's hex value into my clipboard because I'm gonna use the exact same color for its destination. The only difference is I'm gonna make it 100% transparent so that it fades out into nothingness, like a nice tapered shadow. And then I can just pop up for air and go back to my root level of symbology layers for this forest. I'd like to be a little bit more explicit with the color though, so I'll go into the layers and I'll add a symbol layer called stroke layer. I'm just adding a new outline, and I'll drag it all the way down to the bottom of my list of symbol layers. And then I'll style it up as a gradient stroke. And kind of like the tree trunk shadows, I'm gonna make this go from a bolder green to a transparent version of that green. I'll make it reasonably thick, 7 points, and then I'll give it a negative offset of about half of its thickness, and I'll set its accuracy to accurate. And I like to move it over, nudge it, just like I did with those tree trunk shadows. So I'll add a move effect to this gradient stroke. And then I can just push it over to the right with the X offset, and then move it down with a negative Y offset. And once more, I'll give it a color gradient of semi-transparent green to fully transparent green. And we get this really nice verdant shade effect. And then lastly, I'll expand its appearance dropdown and choose color scheme properties because I want to taper off this gradient a little bit more. And I do that by adding in a couple more color stops and then just shifting them over to the right. This gives me less of a linearly rigid gradient. And I actually like it so much that I'd like to do the same thing on top of my forest perimeter. So I'm going to make another stroke layer, and similarly, this will be a gradient, and it's gonna live on top of all my symbol layers. And I'm gonna make this gradient stroke very thick, 36 points. And so it renders only on the inside of my forest blob instead of being centered along the edge. I'll give it a negative offset. In this case, negative 14 looks pretty good to me. And I'm gonna give this gradient the same exact color, but I'm gonna make it much more transparent. I'll start with 85% transparent and then transition to 100% transparent, which is pretty subtle, but that's what I'm going for. Now I'm gonna give it a dash effect because I want this edge to not be perfect. I want it to be clumpy and chunky. So I'll give it a dash effect and then I'll play with its template. 12 on, 44 off, 15 on, 45 off, a little bit on, a lot off. That's the point. And it just adds a little bit more organic irregularity to this tinting. And organic irregularity is sort of the name of the game for this kind of thing. We want forests that look like they've sprung from the imagination of an author and rendered by the pen and brush of an illustrator. Okay, you've done all this work. You don't want to lose it. You want to make it easily shared with other projects or other people. Here's how to do that. In this ArcGIS Pro project, I'll choose the View tab and open up the Catalog pane. There's a folder called Styles. I can import an existing style, or I can create a brand new style. You can save this style locally and name it whatever you want. And this new style gets added to your project. And the cool thing about styles is it provides consistent cartography across all your maps and even all the people on your team. Or you can use styles in a devious way to make new map friends, like I do. Now in our symbology panel, there's an option to save all this work to a style. By default, you could save it to the favorites style, which lives on your computer and follows you from project to project. Or you could save it to a custom style, like we just made. And when it comes time to use these symbols, you'll find them all right here in the gallery tab. Now this was just part one, forests. Join me for the next video in the series where I'll walk through other forms that you can style up, like mountains, water, and then we'll wrap it up with great data to use for these maps.